Good morning and welcome to JW3's Holocaust Memorial Day. My name is Michelle Hine and I'm the Holocaust Education Program at JW3. I'm delighted to welcome you all, wherever you are in the UK and the globe, to join us today at this very special commemoration, which is supported by Genesis Philanthropy Group. Genesis are key partners for JW3 and we thank them. I would particularly like to mention the services are joining us this morning as well. For those of you who saw regularly at JW3, miss you, and we send you very best wishes and look to having you back when it's safe to do so. In past years, we've held our Holocaust Memorial Day at JW3, our vibrant Jewish community centre in North London. The temporary closure of our building due to COVID-19 means we can't welcome people in the same way, yet we've been able to offer arts, culture and education remotely. We hope today's event carries the same significance, meaning and poignance as any other ceremony. This year's theme for Holocaust Memorial Day is Be the Light in the Darkness. The global pandemic has brought uncertainty to us all, yet it's also been a period in which people have brought light to their friends and neighbours. As poet Amanda Gorman said on the steps of the Capitol a week ago, there is always light, if only we're brave enough to see it. If only we're brave enough to be it. In a dark time, the Jewish community has seen that light and been that light. Today, you will hear from prominent speakers about the light in their darkness. Holocaust Memorial Day helps us to remember and provides us with an opportunity for you to bear witness to testimony, and we commemorate the atrocities of the Holocaust. I urge you to use today as a chance to reflect and carry these stories forward. My colleague Trudy Gold will chair our event today. Trudy is a historian and former CEO of the London Jewish Cultural Centre. Trudy, over to you.
Thank you very much, Michelle, and thank you for all your hard work. And a special welcome to the survivors of the Holocaust who I know are listening today. And it's extraordinary that it's actually 76 years ago that a Ukrainian regiment attached to the Soviet army came across a vast camp some 80 kilometres from the beautiful historic city of Krakow. I always think there is a marvellous juxtaposition between great beauty and yet great evil. And it's marvellous in the real sense. It should make us marvel at the horror and of the beauty of the world. It was a freezing cold day, and what they found was 7,000 tragic, emaciated victims who were still alive. Because knowing that the Soviets were advancing, the Germans, so desperate to destroy the Jews, had put thousands of them on the death march back into Germany. The camp, to give it the German name, was Auschwitz, and it was the largest of the death camps in Nazi-occupied Poland. And what they discovered was a stark visualization of, to me and to many people, what's the nadir of Western civilization. Tragically, mass murder goes back to the dawn of history. But what makes the Holocaust a watershed? A warning cry that we are not heeding. There are questions that must be answered. How was it that one of the best educated, most cultured countries in the world elected into power a Nazi party at whose core belief was a system based on a nightmarish theory of racial superiority? A party elected into power that once in power dismembered all opposition and made the Nazi party the state. A party, one of whose first acts in power was to establish a camp in Dachau. The sign above the gates of Dachau was tolerance is a sign of weakness. This party then systematically, socially, economically, and politically excluded the Jews from society. And then, under cover of World War II, it tyrannized, It terrorized, it starved and ghettoized them. And then after Operation Barbarossa in the summer of 41, the invasion of Russia, it began the total elimination of all Jewish men, women and children, 1.5 million children. Birth was sentence of death. In this insane world, Jews were not the only victims. The Roma, Jehovah's Witnesses, Quakers, homosexuals, and the physically and mentally incapacitated, the majority of whom were themselves German, all were under sentence. Slavs, who were considered racially at the bottom of the Nazi pile, were expendable. How did it come to this? How was it in the 20th century, the so-called century of progress, that ordinary decent people, in inverted commas, voted for an insane party? How was it that the largest membership of the Nazi party were the so-called educated professions, the legal, the medical and teaching professions? The majority of those who sat round the table at Wannsee when the final solution of the Jewish question was finally written down, the majority of them had PhDs in law from top German universities. When we deal with the Einsatzgruppen, the hit squads, the 3,000 elite SS officers who were actually in charge of the murders in Russia, the bulk of them had PhDs from top German universities, and one of the leaders was a pastor. How was it that Joseph Goebbels, the best spin doctor of the 20th century, when he came up with his concept of fake news, it was believed by so many. His famous quote, "If you tell a lie often enough, it is believed." And how Hitler said, "You don't tell little lies, you tell big lies. They're easier to believe." How was it that so many people for other nations were willing collaborators in mass murder? How was it that even when there was knowledge of the Holocaust, there was a minute's silence in the House of Commons on December the 17th, 1942? The Allies were at best indifferent to the plight of the Jews and sometimes complicit. How was it that modern technology and bureaucracy were allied to factories of death? These are the major questions as far as I'm concerned. And as far as I'm concerned, they have not been properly answered. Yes, we have tried sticking plasters. The term genocide itself was coined by a Polish Jew, a man called Raphael Lemkin, who was the child of Polish victims of the Holocaust. It led to the 1949 Convention on Human Rights. Gradually, as more and more knowledge of the Holocaust was revealed by historians, and particularly after the collapse of the Soviet Union, in 1991, it went on the core curriculum in Britain. There was this naive belief that if we educated people, then perhaps the world would become a better place. And this is, of course, to the credit of those amazing survivors. And I do believe they have an impact on children. But what I don't believe is that impact on children is taken in as to understand who the Jewish people are. I think one of the greatest flaws in our education system, as far as the Shoah is concerned, is we do not tell the story of the Jews. You know, there are 300 Holocaust memorials throughout the world. Have they made a world a better place? I was present in 2000 when the Swedish Prime Minister had convened the first ever international conference of the third millennium. He had realized that anti-Semitism was alive and well in Sweden. So he called together other countries, 60 governments sent either a head of state, prime minister or foreign minister. The NGOs were there and the Stockholm Declaration was created. It was actually the words of Yehuda Bauer, who we're speaking later today. We were going to use the horrific example of the Shoah to make people more sensible, to make people more sensitive to all kinds of racism. And we hoped that it would eradicate anti-Semitism. And yet, let's look at the 21st century. What have we had? Senseless wars, famine. Even in so-called civilized Britain, do you know how many children haven't got enough to eat? And now we have pestilence. We have economic, we have political and social disintegration. Anti-Semitism, called the longest hatred, still walks the world. To quote Jonathan Sacks, first they hated our religion, then they hated our race, and now they hated our nation. And yet, is there light? I find light in listening to survivors, those magnificent people who've dedicated their lives to making people understand. I find light studying rescuers and resistors in every situation. Can we discover their DNA? And let me now turn to great works of literature, one to the dark and one a warning cry. Let's start with the warning cry. Bertolt Brecht, his masterpiece, The Resistible Rise of Arturo Uy. Therefore, learn how to see and not to gape, to act instead of talking all day long. The world was almost lost to such an ape. The nations put him where his kind belong, but don't rejoice too soon at the end of pain. The bitch that bore him is on heat again. And I'm going to conclude with the words of the marvellous Vasily Grossman from Forever Flowing. Vasily Grossman was a brilliant Russian Jewish writer who accompanied the Red Army and was present at many of the liberations and also saw some of the killing sites of the Einsatzgruppen. Don't you remember how you once answered a question of mine? Me, I shall never forget your words. These words of yours opened my eyes. They brought me the light of day. I asked, how could the Germans send Jewish children to die in the gas chambers? How, I asked, could they live with themselves after that? Was there really no judgment passed on them, either by man or by God? And you said only one judgment is passed on the executioner. He ceases to be a human being. Through looking on his victim as less than human, he becomes his own executioner. He executes the human being inside himself. But the victim, no matter what the executioner does to him, remains a human being forever. Thank you very much. It's now my great pleasure to introduce Rob Rinder. He is a British barrister and also a very interesting television personality. Recently, he appeared in a two-part BBC programme tracing his roots called My Family, The Holocaust and Me. Rob, over to you.
I believe in the sun, even when it's not shining. And I believe in love, even when there's no one there. And I believe in God, even when he is silent. I believe through any trial there is always a way, but sometimes in this suffering and hopeless despair, my heart cries for shelter to know that someone's there. But a voice rises within me saying, hold on, my child, I'll give you strength, I'll give you hope, just stay a little while. I believe in the sun, even when it's not shining, and I believe in love, even when there's no one there. But I believe in God, even when he is silent. I believe through any trial, there is always a way. May there someday be sunshine. May there someday be happiness. May there someday be love. May there someday be peace.
Rob, you've just read a poem that was written in Theresienstadt, and yet is about hope, although we know the person died. And also the theme this year is light in the darkness. Bearing in mind you've just made an extraordinary film with your mother when you went back to trace your own roots, how do you feel with this kind of memorial this year?
You know, my grandfather, Moshe, was liberated in Theresienstadt. So as I stood there reading that poem, I was thinking about those words of hope. And my grandfather was, in every sense, Judy, the thread that weaves into the tapestry of who I am, informed just about everything. And as you saw in the program I made with the BBC and my mum, that the last moment that you will have seen was me sitting on the earth in Treblinka. And underneath that ground, the sun shining and a rainbow above us, it belied complete human horror. And the thing that I was most worried about going on that journey, sitting on that earth, was that it would rob me of my optimism. An optimism that I'd been gifted by my grandfather. And, you know, it is, as you will know, and other people who have had the privilege and profound gift to spend time just in the physical space of the survivors. In every case, it's to be present and to be imbued, immersed, almost enveloped in this sense of unique light.
How was it that your grandfather was an optimist? What was it in him that made him turn to the light?
You know, it's an interesting thing. I don't think one is necessarily born with optimism. There are two elements to me to the survivors. Optimism and this wonderful Yiddish word of davka.
Yes.
It's a beautiful word. It's one which doesn't just inform how I feel, but really does characterize all of them. It's that sense that nobody outside of me gets to curate, gets to determine, gets to decide the narrative of who I am. It's a sense of emotional muscle, of power, of I choose to live my life and I'll do it on my terms. I won't be held down. I won't be asphyxiated by the power of your hate. I'll choose to live my life in love. And when I was in Treblinka, there was a moment you may have seen, standing on that ground, we didn't know who was going to be there, with Leon Ritz.
Yes.
The last human being who had witnessed what had taken place there. And what you wouldn't have heard, but it was the most profound moment of my life, Trudy, was we had gone with a very specific mission to make Kaddish for my grandfather's family. And I wanted to stay their names into the universe to gift them back their humanity, the name, to perform that Jewish ritual. It mattered, it mattered. As we stood by that central stone monolith, my mum got a siddur out, which you would have seen. And I can't say for sure he touched me, but I know I felt it. Check the rushes back. He just reached around and he said, no, no, he said, this is for Kol Yisrael and all the living people of the world. It's the last thing he said. You know, I have taken survivors to schools and those are always the most moving and meaningful events. I sat at a school very ethnically and socioeconomically diverse with Harry Spiro to a group of 14 to 15 year olds, some younger too. And the quality of the questions they asked and the emotional range and their literacy, their willingness to hear, their capacity to be changed, to be moved. And I think there is an opportunity when we tell these stories to make them resonant into people's personal lives in a very important way. And there were a number of features of the film that we made, and perhaps there were two that were the most important for me. The first is that when we tell the stories, when we talk about the Shoah, it's
It's not enough to even eloquently give an account of the history of anti-Semitism, then that's extremely important. Mm-hmm. That's problematic for this reason, I think, Julia. I don't know how you feel about it. Increasingly how we engage socially, and it's especially true of young people, your political views, your ideologies, no longer sit in the logical cortex of your mind. Mm-hmm. And so consequently, facts bounce off. How you feel politically, it sits in the part of your brain which governs the emotion, where identity rests. And so if I perhaps challenge a deep-seated view you have, I'm threatening your identity. Mm. And so consequently, I'm no longer listening. And so I'm increasingly persuaded the best way to engage is with examples.
The personal stories.
To be clear that I've heard what you've had to say, but just let me tell you this story. Mm. And I think if you do that with honesty and authenticity and emotional intelligence, people are prepared to listen and they will. And, you know, the two elements that mattered to me was firstly that each one of the stories we told, apart from my own, was located in Western Europe. Mm. I wanted people to understand, to see, to experience and to be able to touch what Germany, what Holland, Amsterdam, and France looked and felt like, that it wasn't removed, wasn't terribly removed from our own lived experiences of today. Very often, I think there's a problem that the Shoah, the Holocaust, is presented through the prism of black and white, beyond the historical fingertips of most people. And so consequently, as if it were an explosion of violence between one unassimilated shtetl community versus another. And that, of course, does such violence to the critical message for all of us. That the darkness took root in the most advanced liberal democracy in the world. And so consequently, we all have a shared duty never to be complacent.
That's such an important message. And obviously, you're completely right. The personal experience is what gets to other people's emotions. Mm. My challenge, and I think the challenge for all of us, is actually to go the stage beyond that. We have to challenge that emotional side of the brain, actually, because one thing that Nazism should teach us, and as you said, Rob, we're dealing with one of the most civilized, sophisticated nations in the world. Mm-hmm. And one of the other issues I find so terrible is how many people bought into it, went along with it. Ideology is on the march again. People want their mantras. They want their sort of comfort spaces. Right. And that is terrifying.
So the other element is, how do we teach people to be courageous? What do we take from these stories? And for me, the light exists in this critical form, that when you hear the stories of the Shoah, when we talk about it, it's not enough to hear it. It's not enough to be sitting in a lecture. There's something more powerful. The light emerges from a personal responsibility. Mm. On this notion, it's not a notion, it's a credo, it seems to me, that I become a witness. Mm. So when I've heard this story, my next question is, okay, what do I do now?
What do you do with it?
And how we use today as an opportunity to make people more brave and more courageous, to feel that they have a personal responsibility to be courageous. You know, on the night that program went out, 3.5 million people watched it. And by the time of us sitting here, it'll be closer to 4.5 million. Mm. In total for the both programs, it'll be between 7 and 8 million people, many of whom knew nothing or little about the Shoah at all. Mm. Certainly very few of them watched BBC. Not a peep of anti-Semitism on social media when it went out.
That's perfect.
Some really good news. People with a thirst to understand, a desire to know. And perhaps my most optimistic thought of all is this, that, you know, it was Maya Angelou who said you can't practice any of the virtues consistently without courage. Mm. One of the things that we wanted to include, which was in the second programme, the story of Marianne Cohen, but there was little bits of light dotted about all of the stories, was that I think people, when they see the stories of the Holocaust, want to imagine that presented, confronted by that situation, more than ever now, they want to believe that they'd be on the side of good. Mm. We know that in reality, very often that's not the case.
So perhaps I think it's important to tell the story of the rescuers. Mm. The more you show courage, the more you demonstrate what it is, what it looks like, the more you present it in human form, that's who and what we aspire to.
In a time which is so gloomy, we have to turn to the light. That's the human condition, isn't it? Mm. But my last comment is, I know identity sits in emotion. Let's go back to the ideas of the Enlightenment. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could learn to apply reason?
Maybe, but you know, you can no longer do that than disinvent dynamite. We are where we are. We engage in the way that we do nowadays. Mm. And it's very important. It is right to say that anti-Semitism continues to have a dark shadow. But despite the shadow, we can be the candle. And you're right, courage can be that candle. But reminding people that courage starts with them, and it starts in every aspect of their daily lives.
Little kindnesses, actually.
Little kindnesses, to be sure. But that you personally...
Personal responsibility.
Have a responsibility.
Yeah.
And I worry a great deal that needs to be articulated in a positive way. Mm. Don't want to be told just on its own that they're anti-Semitic, that they're racist, that they're full of prejudice, despite the fact that may be the social fabric that has informed their views and how they are. That's only a part of it. People want to be told what's possible. People want to be given the information. People want to believe they can be at their best. Give them the examples of people who lived and breathed that, confronted by the most challenging thing imaginable. And I think if you build that, people will lift themselves up to that light.
Thank you, Rob.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure to introduce the Right Honourable Dame Margaret Hodge. She has been a member of the Labour Party, Member of Parliament, and at the heart of Barking and Dagenham since 1994. She's held several government positions, but lately she has been involved in that terrible fight within the Labour Party regarding anti-Semitism, in which she has showed great courage and bravery. Over to you, Margaret.
I was asked, as we spend time remembering the horrors of the Holocaust and reflecting on the lessons we continue to need to learn and talk about, I was asked to talk about my experiences during the last 5 years as we battled against the scourge of anti-Semitism in my Labour Party. When I first became an MP, some 26 years ago now, I was a Labour MP who happened to be Jewish. Fighting anti-Semitism in my political party has changed that. I'm now a Jewish Labour MP, determined to root out anti-Jewish hatred from the party and dedicated to restoring my party to its traditional and core values of fighting racism, promoting equality, and valuing solidarity. There's nothing I want more than to be able to return to the normality of the past, when I spend all my time responding to my constituents' needs and concerns, whether it was about housing, antisocial behaviour, or rat runs running through their local community, and playing a leading role in Parliament on fighting corruption and money laundering and promoting tax justice. And the election of Keir Starmer as our new leader of the Labour Party gives me hope that that is now not just possible, but probable. And I can't begin to describe to you the relief I feel as I start to see light at the end of a long, dark, and terrifying tunnel that for me will always represent those years when Jeremy Corbyn was our leader and the Corbynistas were in control of the Labour Party. I never, ever thought that Jeremy Corbyn and the Corbynistas would enable anti-Semitism to move from the fringes of the Labour Party, where it's always been, into the mainstream. I never, ever dreamt that the party that was the natural home for Jews, for so many Jews like me, whose history was bound up with fleeing from countries because we, our parents and our grandparents, were hated, abused, segregated, and ultimately murdered. I never thought that the Labour Party would become a hostile environment for Jews. I never, ever thought that my Jewish identity would become the driver of my political activity. But what I have learned from the Holocaust is that we must never stand by and allow anti-Semitism to remain unchallenged. If we do not call it out, whenever and wherever we see it, we could simply be allowing it to spread and to grow. That's why the last 4 to 5 years have been so important. And I want to start by saluting the three women Jewish Labour MPs with whom I stood together and where we stood in our determination to eradicate anti-Semitism. I'm talking about Luciana Berger, Ruth Smith, and Louise Ellman. It's been a remarkable feature of our campaign that it's the Jewish women in Parliament who spoke out more loudly and most consistently against anti-Semitism. Of course, we've been supported by Jewish activists up and down the country, and particularly those in the Jewish labor movement who've always been there for us and with us. And of course, there have been colleagues in Parliament who bravely and consistently stood on our side and fought with us. I'm thinking of people like John Mann, Wes Streeting, Rosie Duffield, Stella Creasy, and others. But it's been the Jewish women Labour MPs who've borne the brunt of the vile abuse that's been hurled at us, particularly on social media. I've been regularly called a Zionist stooge, a Zionist bitch, a Zionist pig, an old Zionist hag, and a Zionist shill. People have said to me, why has half of 1% of our population got so much power? Rid us of this cancer. I've been told a swastika is appropriate as Israel is a fascist state. And people have said, Margaret Hodge is a Zionist pig, and hopefully Hezbollah will catch up with the bitch. And I've only read to you some of the less offensive examples of abuse that I've received. Most recently, in the 2 months of October and November in 2020, I have received 90,000 different separate mentions on social media. Not all of them negative, but most of them abusive. I think that is in part because I am the last Labour woman member of Parliament fighting from within the Labour Party. But it's also in part reflects the extent to which anti-Semitism is still prevalent within the party. What it feels like is an Orwellian mission to create a false universe, to paint me as somebody who's untrustworthy, wicked, not to be trusted, and in that way to silence me in everything I say and to undermine me when I talk about anti-Semitism. What's been most difficult for me is that this hasn't come from the fascist right who I fought when the BNP challenged me in the 2010 general election. It's come from the fascist left. And what is particularly abhorrent is that the fascist left have chosen to take literally pieces of literature that were used against me in the 2010 general election campaign, copied and pasted them, and then put them on social media to attack me in 2020. The fascist left and the fascist right have too much in common. I understand why the abuse became intolerable for some of my colleagues, and I respect their position, but I do miss them today as colleagues working with me inside the party. Keir Starmer has made rooting out anti-Semitism his top priority. We were the first people he contacted after he was successful in the leadership campaign. He now has regular meetings with all the leaders of the Jewish communal groups. He has shown that he's not just expressing warm words, but is prepared to take tough action, both in the action he took against Rebecca Long Bailey, in the fact that parties are now being suspended, and in the fact that many individuals are being either suspended or expelled from the Labour Party. I had hoped that the EHRC report into anti-Semitism would provide that line in the sand and allow us to move forward. Indeed, it was a much more hard-hitting, direct and clear report with a strong set of recommendations than I had thought was possible. I thought we were going to get something that talked about Labour Party processes like record keeping. We didn't. We got direct criticism of the Labour Party that we had acted illegally. Jeremy Corbyn's intervention in that process was outrageous and simply has moved us back. His assertion that the EHRC report, a report by a statutory body, was exaggerated, and his determined repetition of the allegation that people like me were only fighting anti-Semitism because we weaponized it against him was outrageous. I regretted the fact that under a broken system, he was allowed back after a short suspension. But I do applaud Keir Starmer's action in refusing to let him stand as a Labour Member of Parliament until he decides himself to take action. And I think what he needs to do is accept his responsibility for what happened on his watch. I think he needs to accept without question the EHRC report on anti-Semitism in its entirety. And he has to finally give an unconditional, not conditional, apology to all of those who have been so hurt by what has happened in the Labour Party over the last few years. But despite Jeremy Corbyn, we have started that long journey to transform the culture within the Labour Party, and that long and difficult journey to rebuild trust. The theme of this year's Holocaust Remembrance Day is light in the darkness. And I really do sincerely believe that I've begun to see that light. We've still got a long, long way to go, but we're moving in the right direction. The building blocks are being put in place. The moves to have an independent complaints mechanism within the party that cannot be influenced by politicians. The training and education program that is absolutely essential for rooting out what has become mainstream in the party. And the committed and continuing leadership, both of Keir Starmer and the deputy leader, Angela Rayner. I really do think there is light in the darkness, and I promise you that I personally will do all I can to both nurture that light and to conquer the darkness.
Pleasure to introduce Gemma Rosefield and Benjamin Nabarro, two very talented musicians who have worked with us for many years. They are now going to play the Kaddish by Ravel. I have great pleasure in introducing to you Joan Salter. Joan is a Holocaust survivor, a child survivor. She was born in Brussels in February 1940 to Polish Jewish parents. She was only 3 months old when the Nazis invaded. Joan is going to talk about the rescuers who saved her life and brought life and light into her life.
My name now is Joan Salter. But when I was born in February 1940 in Brussels, Belgium, I was named Fanny Zimmerbaum. My parents were Polish Jews who had lived in Western Europe for most of their adult lives. Now, they had lived mainly in Paris, but when Poland was occupied and he had letters from his family in Poland saying they had been put into a ghetto, my father realized which way things were happening, and he thought Belgium would stay neutral. So my parents, with my half-sister, because my mother had been a widow when she met my father and had a young child, they moved into Belgium. And I was born in February 1940, and the Nazis occupied Belgium in May 1940. So I was 3.5 months old. Initially, they were rounding up the foreign men of work age because they wanted to keep up this image that they were only deporting Jews for use in labor camps to help with the munitions and things. So my father was taken, and eventually he was deported to the East. But my father, being the sort of guy he was, he jumped from the train and he made his way back to Paris. And he went into hiding with a cousin of his who lived in Paris. So my mother, we stayed in Belgium for a few months, and then she got permission from the police for us to travel to Paris, where she had lived most of her adult life. And we stayed for a little while with two of my aunts and cousins. My mother was the second youngest of eight adults, and most of her family were professionals, and they were married. The women were married to doctors and accountants, and they had French nationality, although they originally from Poland. So we were together for a while, and then my aunts became worried that because of my father being in hiding, that it would endanger the whole family. And my mother fell out with her sisters, and we actually went and stayed with contacts who were running, who were part of what became known as the Maquis, the underground, and we stayed in a bed and breakfast. Anyway, my father was nearly rounded up in 1941, and he managed to be smuggled down into Vichy. At that time, women and children were not being rounded up, and it was so dangerous being smuggled into Vichy part that it was safer for us to stay in Paris. And we were in Paris up until July 1942. And what is now known as the Veldive Roundup happened over a long weekend in the heat of a July weekend in Paris, 1942. Now, every week we had to go and register with the local police. And it was the same two policemen every week in the room in the police station. And one was a very nasty, really anti-Semitic man who enjoyed taunting the people, and everyone was terrified of him. and the other one was a very kindly, gentle man. So when my mother turned up with my sister and myself, the kindly man had a huge queue of people waiting to register. And the nasty man was so nasty that only one or two brave souls stood in front of him. And because my mother had two young children, she wanted to get out as quickly as possible, so she joined the short queue. And what happened next is my sister, who was very resentful of having a baby sister and who couldn't understand why she wasn't allowed to play with her friends and everything, and she was very jealous. So my mother was holding me, and I was nearly 3 years old, and I was quite a heavy little girl. And so my sister started pulling on me, saying to Mummy, "Put her down, pick me up." And we started crying and shouting. And the nasty policeman, who was very anti-Semitic, told my mother to take her little pigs outside and wait there and everything. And my mother was a very quiet woman. And we waited until everyone had registered. And in fact, that turned out to be very lucky, because when we went back inside and joined the now empty room in front of the very kindly policeman, he pretended he couldn't find our name on his list. And he turned to the other guy and said, "There's another list in the office. Can you go and look?" And the minute he left, the kindly man said to us, "They are starting to round up women and children this weekend. If you've got anywhere to hide, go." And my mother went back to the hotel that we were staying at, and they managed to smuggle us out in the early morning in a huge a laundry van, because hotels and things didn't have washing machines, would come to collect all the linen. And they had a big wicker basket, and we were hidden in the bottom of the basket with huge amount of laundry put on top. And those, the policeman and the man who drove us, were two what we would call light in the darkness, because these roundups were absolutely terrible. The women and children were kept over a very hot weekend in a velodrome, while the children were separated from the mothers forcibly, and the children were sent to an internment camp called Drancy. And at 3 years old, I would not have survived that. And so we were very lucky. And this year's Memorial Day commemorates those who were the light in the darkness. And that policeman was our first light in the darkness, because had he not warned us, there is no way I would have survived both the roundup and being in Drancy. And 11,000 children were eventually deported from France to the camps in the East, unaccompanied, on trains. So the driver of the van who smuggles across the border, it was very dangerous for him because it was a border and there were guards. So they smuggled us down into Vichy, and for a little while we were safe there. However, in November 1942, the Germans took over the whole of France, and they began again rounding up not just the men, but also women and children, in readiness to deport them. And my parents had been very well off before the Holocaust, and my mother still had some jewelry, and she used it to bribe what was known as a passeur, who helped us to climb the mountains, together with a group of airmen who were being smuggled across into Spain.
And we were in the mountains for 3 nights and it was very cold and we were hungry and crying. And by this time there were Nazis in the mountains. And the pastor said to my mother, if you cannot stop them crying, you are endangering the whole group and you must suffocate your children. So my mother somehow managed to keep us quiet and we climbed the mountains, but we were caught at the border with Spain. And Franco was assumed to be an ally of Hitler. However, Spain allowed us in, and my sister was put in a convent, and my mother and I were imprisoned. However, the local people were very kind to us, and they brought us food, and the prison guards let us out in the day and play. Then the Quakers, who were the relief organization in Spain, Jewish organizations were not allowed in, but the Quakers and the Red Cross were allowed. They came to my mother in prison and said, the Americans have sent a ship to take the children away. Let them go because there's nowhere left but the ocean. And if Spain is occupied, you and your children will be deported. I don't remember leaving my mother, but as a mother and grandmother myself, I can only imagine what it must have been for her who had gone through 3 years of running and hiding, living on her own, knowing that her parents in Poland had been murdered, that some of her family in Poland had been murdered, and yet she gave us up. And we went to America. My sister had a different surname because she was from my mother's first marriage. And we were separated. And I was put in an orphanage and I was fostered by an American family. And it was not until late 1947 that through the Red Cross, we were reunited with our parents who had managed to get to England and had settled here. And although people say, oh, how lucky you were, and you must be grateful, as a teenager, as I was at the time, a pre-teenager, being reunited with parents, I didn't remember. My mother and I didn't even have a common language. They were completely broken, impoverished, and it was not happy ever after. It was very, very difficult. And although, yes, we were one of the lucky families, the results of those years of under the watchful eye of the Nazis and the collaborative police of Vichy, those scars do not leave you. However, I am grateful to the policemen, and actually, I have recently found evidence that something like 400 policemen were shot for disobeying orders. So in the worst of times, in the darkness, there are still the individuals who are a light in the darkness. Thank you very much.
May I now introduce Sam Helfgott. He is the grandson of the great Sir Ben Helfgott, who is a very close friend of mine. Sir Ben is an extraordinary man. He was the British weightlifting champion and for years was an advisor to the ITF, now known as IRA. His grandfather has been the light of his life throughout his lifetime, giving him guidance and optimism.
My name is Sam Helfgott, and I am proud to be one of Sir Ben Helfgott's 9 grandchildren. I have been lucky enough to observe, learn, love, and be loved by my grandpa for 23 years. Throughout my life, I, like many others, have been inspired by his tireless work and ferocious determination to remember and commemorate the Holocaust. First, I'm going to speak about his story before explaining its importance and finishing with why he is my personal light in the darkness. My grandpa was born in November 1929 in Piotrków Trybunalski, a town in Poland, southwest of Warsaw. Born into a stable family, he enjoyed a normal family life, playing with friends, going to school, visiting grandparents during vacations, and being raised by devoted, caring, and loving parents. This scenario was to change dramatically when on the 1st of September 1939, a couple of months before his 10th birthday, Poland was invaded, signalling the start of the Second World War. From that day until the 9th of May 1945, more than 5.5 years later, he was a victim of Nazi persecution. He survived the war, but with the exception of his sister Marla, none of his immediate family survived. Both his mother, my great-grandmother, and his other sister, my great-aunt, were killed, together with 550 others in the Rakow Forest, just outside of Piotrków, having been incarcerated in the local synagogue for 2 weeks prior. His father, my great-grandfather, was shot dead whilst trying to escape a death march 2 weeks before liberation. In the 3 years prior to the end of the war, Grandpa was subjected to living in a ghetto, used as a slave labourer in both a glass factory and a wood factory, and was incarcerated in the concentration camps of Buchenwald, where he was separated from his father, and in Schlieben. He was liberated in Theresienstadt in Czechoslovakia. My grandpa came to the UK in 1945 as part of a group of 732 children, flown in by the Royal Air Force to be settled in hostels run by World Jewish Relief. The government at the time had given permission for 1,000 refugees to be brought over, but tragically, the authorities couldn't find that many. This group, male and female, became known as the Boys. He was placed in a hostel near Windermere with fellow survivors who became lifelong friends. From there, he went to London, gained a place at Plaistow Grammar School, and passed his higher school certificate just a couple of years after he had arrived in Britain speaking no English. As part of his inculcation in British culture, sport had become almost an obsession, particularly weightlifting. This started in 1948 when he was swimming in the ponds on Hampstead Heath and saw people lifting weights. Asking one of them if he could join in, he was faced with a firm no. My grandpa, unperturbed by their reaction, persuaded them and lifted the weights anyway. He lifted 180 pounds with ease to the bemusement of the spectators. For context, he weighed only 150 pounds at the time. Fast forward to the Melbourne Olympics in 1956, he captained the British weightlifting team only 11 years after coming to the UK as a 15-year-old. He would go on to captain the team in the Rome Olympics 4 years later, and also win gold 3 times at the Jewish Olympics, the Maccabiah Games in Israel. This story is symbolic of Grandpa's drive and can-do attitude. From very early on, Grandpa has dedicated his life to promoting research, education, and remembrance of the Holocaust in the hope that the lessons of the Holocaust may be learned and understood. He was a keynote speaker at the Stockholm Conference in 2000 that concluded in the signing of the Stockholm Declaration, which led to the establishment of Holocaust Memorial Day and the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance. He served on the commission set up by Prime Minister David Cameron to establish a Holocaust Memorial and Learning Centre in London beside Parliament. He is also a founding trustee of the Holocaust Education Trust and a founder of the 45 Aid Society, a charity established by the Boys to raise money for charitable causes to give back to society and look after one another. One of the greatest pleasures of my year is to attend the 45 Aid Society annual reunion, where the surviving boys and their families come together for an evening of celebration. It is sad that each year there are fewer of the boys, but it is truly uplifting to see the increasing turnout of family members still attending, showing that they will never be forgotten and that the familial bonds will remain. Grandpa is an institution builder, not because he is vain or because he wants to establish a personal legacy, but because he is uniquely capable of bringing together diverse groups of people in the shared pursuit of a common goal. He is a leader because he unites people and includes rather than excludes. The whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Without doubt, the proudest day of my life was when he was knighted by Prince Charles in 2018 for services to Holocaust remembrance and education. I will never forget the goosebumps I had when I saw the sword touch his shoulder. My grandpa's story is important because it is a triumph over adversity. He suffered the most abhorrent period in human history, but did not let cruelty and injustice break his spirit. He refused to poison his life with revenge because hatred is corrosive. Instead, he was left with a dream to live in a world of understanding, compassion, fraternity, and love for humanity. As the great late Rabbi Lord Sacks said, The greatest danger any civilization faces is when it suffers collective amnesia. My grandpa has lived his life to prevent this from happening. I strongly believe that in a divided and partisan world, education and tolerance have never been more important. The lessons from the Holocaust must form the cultural code for education towards humane values, democracy, human rights, and opposition to racism and totalitarian ideologies. Out of everything he has achieved, the achievement that Grandpa is most proud of is his family. Nothing gives him greater pleasure than to be surrounded by us all on a Friday night or a Sunday morning. Grandpa creates a culture of drive and achievement, not because he is demanding, but the smile on his face when he hears of success makes you want to deliver more. He was so proud of me on my university graduation day that he insisted on being at the front of the queue for the ceremony two before mine. He can be difficult to please. An endearing memory is when, having rightly nudged me for years about my lack of reading, he saw me reading a book and asked why I wasn't reading the one that he had recommended. I feel extremely lucky that my hero is also my grandpa. There have been difficult personal moments in my life where the memories and cognizance of his upbringing and subsequent achievements have helped me to focus and overcome the struggle. I strive every day to make him proud, although I know he is disappointed that I still haven't managed to find a wife. So, what have I taken from my grandpa? I have learned the importance of education, tolerance, and forgiveness. I have observed true determination, fervor, and purpose. I have admired a man who receives such joy from the achievements of others and accepts publicity not for what it does for his personal profile, but for the cause that he is committed to. I have been taught the necessity of relationships, family, and reputation. Ultimately, I have been blessed to receive unconditional love from a man that saw the worst of humanity and used that as fuel to create a family, the family that I am fortunate to be a part of, and to dedicate his life to ensuring that the Holocaust should never, ever be forgotten. As the prophet Isaiah conceptualized, Grandpa is truly a light unto the nations. My grandfather, Sir Ben Helfgott, Holocaust survivor, my hero, the light in our lives.
May I please welcome back Gemma and Ben, who will perform The Song of the Birds by Pablo Casals.
Thank you.
I now have great pleasure in introducing one of my heroes, Professor Yehuda Bauer. He is Professor Emeritus of History and Holocaust Studies at the Hebrew University and academic advisor to Yad Vashem. As far as I am concerned, he is the most knowledgeable and greatest historian on Holocaust matters throughout the world today. He has worked tirelessly fighting anti-Semitism and doing everything he can to make sure that the Shoah is never forgotten and is taught properly. So again, welcome, Professor Bauer.
What I was asked to speak about is contemporary anti-Semitism and how to deal with it. Now, of course, the very term anti-Semitism is really senseless, because there's no Semitism that you can be anti to. What it means is simply Jew hatred, hatred of Jews, in all kinds of forms and situations and so on. And this, of course, is very ancient. But what happens today, during the corona pandemic all over the world, is a continuation, under certain conditions, of the same kind of thing. One of the major researchers of the Holocaust on anti-Semitism has stated, I think, very correctly, that anti-Semitism in the Christian and Muslim civilizations is part of a very basic attitude which developed over a long period of time and which cannot be dealt with temporary means. Temporary means are very important in themselves. They have to be done, such as, for instance, legislation against anti-Semitism. And there you see you have a difference in the development, because in the 1930s and earlier than that, in both Europe and elsewhere, outside of the Christian-Muslim civilization, there was never any anti-Semitism in China and India and so on. But in those days, in the 20s and 30s, there were governments that explicitly legislated against Jews and acted against Jews, societies that were proud of acting against Jews. Now, you don't have that in countries that are touched by Christian civilization today, such as Europe and the two Americas and some other places. There's no government, no society that openly advocates anti-Semitism. You have problems with political parties, such as in the United Kingdom and in other places, where there are accusations that there's anti-Semitism and there's a problem of how to deal with that. But there's no social agreement that Jews should be hated. It's part of a crisis situation where there are elements in society that continue this. So I think one has to be rather careful about this. And there is a international organization of which the United Kingdom is, of course, a very important member, and that's the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, IHRA, which suggested, or rather passed, a non-legal binding definition of anti-Semitism with examples. This was adopted by the United Kingdom, I think pretty much by all political elements in the United Kingdom. And that, of course, is important in itself. But there is an argument of people in society, of intellectuals and so on and so forth, that the IHRA definition of anti-Semitism actually makes a statement that criticism of the state of Israel is anti-Semitism. That is absolutely wrong. The examples in the definition by IHRA are very clear. Criticism of Israel and its policies are not anti-Semitism unless Israel is attacked because it is a Jewish state and the Jews are the bad people who do the bad things. The Jews. But unless that is the case, criticism of Israel is not anti-Semitic. If it were, then about a third, at least, if not more, of Jews in Israel would be anti-Semites because they criticize the government that rules in Israel at the moment for its policies. Now, so it's quite clear, if you criticize Israel because it's a Jewish state and you don't want a Jewish state, that's anti-Semitism. If you criticize Israel because you disagree with its policy, that's not anti-Semitism. And I think that differentiation is very clear, not very clear to many Jews. And I think it's important to make this definition very, very carefully. Now, during the pandemic, during the corona pandemic, the accusation has been made by anti-Semites, by radical, especially right-wing racists, but not only by them, that the Jews are responsible for the pandemic, that the Jews are somehow gaining from the pandemic, that the Jews somehow invented the pandemic. Now, this is, of course, a repetition of old anti-Semitism during the 14th century, before and after that. The Jews were accused of poisoning the wells, of spreading cholera and the plague and so on, because it was impossible to find the real reasons. And so the enemy within, because they were different, was accused. The basis of anti-Semitism in the past, in the near past, and in the present is that the Jews have a different culture, a different way of seeing the world and life. Now, this is very ancient. It is not a question of biology. The Jews are about as pure racially as any London street poodle. It is quite clear that we are not genetically or biologically, all of us, the same. No, we are not. But we have a culture and a civilization that is very ancient and has a tremendous impact and influence. And because of the situation which Jewish communities found themselves after most of them left the area of the land of Israel, the middle position, they were very well suited for intellectual developments and so on. And so the fact that you have many Jewish Nobel Prize winners and you have important lawyers and intellectuals and writers and theater directors and musicians and so on and so forth is not really surprising. It's quite natural for a group that concentrated in a certain socioeconomic area that they should have this kind of inclination. And I think that it is very important to say that, for instance, in the United States, you find Jews on both sides of the political divide. A minority, but a very important minority, supports the conservative Trumpist side. A majority, a very large majority, supports the Democratic side, the liberal side. But both are very important to both sides. Why? Because they are in this particular position in the United States. So a tiny proportion of the American population, namely the Jews, have an impact, but not as a group. There's no Jewish conspiracy. There's no Jewish organization that controls Jewish action within a society. Not there, and not the Board of Jewish Deputies in the United Kingdom, who have no influence whatsoever on the politics of individual Jews regarding internal matters in the United Kingdom. And the same applies everywhere else. And so what you have is this kind of a problem, that you are attacked because you are different, because you have a different culture, different civilization, in part because in many aspects, you are just exactly the same like your next-door non-Jewish neighbor. Now, what do you do about that? In the United Kingdom and elsewhere, in all places, really, the usual answer is act legally, in other words, pass laws, which is important, but certainly doesn't cover the issue and is not really finally the most efficient way of dealing with it, but it's important. And arguing how lovely and wonderful we are and how many Nobel Prizes we have won, we, as though we are some kind of a group that organizes Nobel Prizes, which is nonsense. Now, I am not a favor, I don't favor this kind of attitude. I don't favor this kind of response to anti-Semitism. In my view, the correct way of addressing anti-Semitism is to attack anti-Semites, because anti-Semitism is a cancer that eats the societies in which it develops. It eats the British society if there's anti-Semitism. It eats the American society. It ate and destroyed ultimately not only the Jews, but the Germans in World War II. It destroys the societies in which it develops. It has to be attacked. Don't defend Jews. Attack anti-Semites. That would be the message that I would spread on the Holocaust Memorial Day. Thank you very much.
We are very fortunate that the memorial prayer, El Mole Rachamim, will be chanted for us by Chazan Johnny Turgle, who himself is the proud grandson of two Holocaust survivors. Welcome, Johnny.
El Mali Rachamim Shochein Bamromim Hamtzei menucha nechona al kanefei ashechina b'malot kedoshim Utarim kezohar harakia mazirim lenishmo Israel, Anashim, Nashim, Vataf, Shenergo, Vishenishchato. Vesheni gbaro chayim bidei hanatzim vozereihem yimach shemam ba'auschwitz maidanik Treblinka, Mauthausen, Bergen-Belsen, ובשאר מחנות ההשמדה. ומסרו נפשם על קדושת השם. בעבור כולנו מתפללים לעילוי נשמתם. לכן בעל הרחמים יסתירי מסתר כנפיו לעולמים, ויצרור בצרור החיים את נשמתם. בגן עדן תהי מנוחתם, אדוני ונחלתם. וינוחו בשלום על משכבם, ונאמר אמן.
Thank you all for joining us today, and I'd like to thank our incredible speakers. And a very special thank you to Trudy Gold, who is an exceptional historian and has taught me so much over the past few years. I will now light my memorial candle. We remember the 6 million who perished during the Holocaust.
Thank you, Michelle. In conclusion, I'd like to say that this lockdown has given us one thing. It's given us time to think. It's given us time to reflect on the kind of world we want to leave for our children and our grandchildren. And what I believe now is that if we believe in freedom, if we believe in fighting racism, if we believe in fighting anti-Semitism, we have to actually understand how to fight it, and we must. And we also must, I've said this every year for the past 5 years, we must reevaluate what we mean by education, because our grandchildren and our children deserve a better world in which they can live and prosper and be kind. Thank you.